The traditional DC motor with carbon brushes is still a frequently used motor today, especially in the lower power range. A reason for us to learn the different DC motor types, how they work, and how you can control the direction of rotation and speed of this motor. Let's take a simple model of a DC motor with one single turn of a conductor placed between two opposite magnetic poles. The main components are labeled as shown and explained later on. To understand how this coil can rotate, we should have a closer look at a current carrying wire within a magnetic field. A current-carrying wire generates a concentric magnetic field, which interacts with the field of the permanent magnet. Magnetic field lines with opposite directions attract each other. Those with same directions push off each other. That's why a force is applied to this wire. The direction of motion can also be described by Fleming's left-hand rule. To the coil, you can apply the principle of the lever. You get a torque. When the coil turns 90 degrees, the brushes lose contact with the commutator and the current stops flowing through the coil. However, the coil keeps turning because of its own momentum. As a result, the commutator rings get interchanged with their contacts to the brushes. Therefore, the current continues to flow in the same direction and you keep the direction of the torque. Now, so far, we only used one single loop in our simple model. This will cause an irregular torque and can cause the motor to stick when the brushes are right between the commutator segments. To avoid this problem, we split the commutator ring and add another loop. Adding more loops to the armature ensures nearly constant torque and therefore continuous spinning. Spring-loaded brushes help to maintain contact during operation. Also, the strength of the torque can be improved by a simple trick. Use loops made of mini wires. At last, we put the winding into a pack of steel lamination. Hereby, we can also enhance the magnetic field of the rotor. Note these laminations are electrically isolated to interrupt the path of the eddy current. All that's missing now is the right case, and our motor is ready to work. Controlling a motor means reversing the direction of rotation and changing the speed in a defined manner. Reversing the direction of rotation of this DC motor is easy. Just reverse the polarity of the armature voltage. For this purpose, the so-called H-bridge is used in practice as a power element. Transistors act as electronic switches, which are mutually interlocked within a branch in order to avoid a short circuit. The diodes parallel to the transistors fulfill two tasks. On the one hand, they act as freewheeling diodes, since the motor coil represents an inductance at which voltage is switched. On the other hand, large motors can generate a voltage themselves when they are braked. In this case, the diodes now bridge the transistors if the motor acts as a generator. But the H-bridge can do even more. Since these transistors can have a very high switching frequency, the average value of the DC voltage can be controlled by the so-called pulse width modulation, also referred to as PWM. You see, the longer the pulses are on within a period, the higher the rotational speed and vice versa. Note that the transistors switch these signals within milliseconds, and therefore the motor cannot go into stop and go due to its own inertia. The average voltage can be determined simply by multiplying the duty cycle by the pulse's high level. Here are some examples. Replace this permanent magnet with a coil connected in series to the armature coil, and you get a so-called series-wound motor with special properties. Note that this field coil should have a low electrical resistance and is therefore wound with relatively fewer but thicker turns. Let's proof our statements and make a real test. Series DC motors have an extremely high starting torque, but why? At the starting point, you have a high current, because the current at this point is only limited by the ohmic resistance of both the armature and the field coil. As a result, both winding can generate a strong magnetic field. As soon as the motor rotates, the current is limited by another effect, the so-called back EMF. Note that the armature conductors move through the magnetic field of the stator, and hence voltage is induced in them as in a generator. Voltage is induced within a loop as soon as it rotates within a magnetic field, according to the principle of electromagnetic induction. This effect also occurs when we apply an external voltage to this loop. This internal EMF, which we call now back EMF or counter EMF, opposes the external voltage according to Lenz's law and therefore reduces the armature current. As this EMF is proportional to the rotational speed of the motor, the armature current at the starting point is very high. That's why big DC motors might need starting aid. Because the torque is proportional to the square of the motor current, we have low torque at high speed. Caution: always start a DC series motor with load. If this motor is operated at no load, the counter EMF produced by the field winding is weak, and so the armature must turn faster to produce sufficient counter EMF to balance the supply voltage. As a result, the motor can be damaged by overspeed. This motor is used wherever a high starting torque is required, for example, the starter in your car. Connect the armature winding in parallel to the field winding. You get a DC shunt motor. The field winding consists of thin but many turns to achieve a strong magnetic flux. So, both winding are exposed to the same power supply. This motor is able to maintain a constant speed with any load, but how so? As we know, the rotating armature produces a back EMF, which opposes the armature voltage and therefore reduces the armature current. If the load on the motor increases, the armature rotation slows, and thus the back EMF also is reduced, since back EMF is proportional to speed. The decrease in back EMF results in an increase in armature current. Since torque is proportional to armature current, torque must also increase. What happens if the field winding gets opened and the motor runs without load? If the field circuit is opened, the back EMF will drop to zero. Take care that the fuses don't blow up with a full armature voltage applied. While the field current decays, the motor will speed up as if in a field weakening mode. To explain it in other words, the motor will try to speed up to develop a back EMF, and with no field, it requires a very large armature current. If you have a large power supply, the fuses will not blow, with the result that the motor will speed up and self-destruct due to centrifugal forces. There is enough torque produced due to remnant flux in the field and a large armature current to accelerate the motor. The DC compound motor belongs also to the self-excited motors and has, as the name suggests, both a series and a shunt field coil connected to the armature winding. This means that this motor has the advantage of high starting torque but also of efficient speed regulation. At this point, we should also mention the universal motor, which can be operated with both AC and DC voltage. This special engine will be explained in a separate video. If you would like more information about electric motors, you can visit our webpage. If you would like to stay up to date on our videos, please subscribe to our channel and never miss a new video.